Well, it's an honor and a pleasure to give this presentation. A little bit scary as well, to be honest. It's the first time to give this presentation with a lot of demos as well. And it's always a little bit, there's some tension in that. So that's healthy and that's good. Welcome. Let's put on this one, that will help as well. Welcome in this session, Windows 8 Gone Wild. It's a combination of demos. I brought some gear. People who are following me on Twitter noticed that customs security has some difficulties with that, but I made it and I brought my gear and it still works. We'll see if it will work in the demos. My name is Ruben. I'm the CTO of PQR. We are based in the Netherlands and focusing on complex infrastructures. I'm enjoying working for PQR for around 10 years, and well, hopefully I can share some knowledge around stuff I discovered with Windows 8 and Windows Server 2012 with you. The agenda is the following. Fuck you, IT, as Brian called it, but we'll see. We'll see what Knickerbocker and the best workplace, what it is. We'll talk about Windows 8 and Server 2012, various use cases, what's new, remote desktop virtualization host, remote desktop session host, what's new around Hyper-V. And I have, well, I think 30 minutes, maybe more, around demos prepared for you. So hopefully in an enjoyable 75 minutes. At the end of this day, it will be tough. It's warm here, well, or it could be me building up this stuff, but it feels pretty warm here, so stay with me with that. So that's the goal, 75 minutes or around 75 minutes, and these are the main topics. So in the beginning, I won't talk directly around Windows 8 and Windows Server 2012. I will set the scene, and that's what I call Knickerbocker, Hewitt, and the best workplace. And then after a minute or 10 maybe, we'll do a deeper dive in Windows 8, what's new, demos, and so forth and so on. So when you have questions, please keep them at the end of the session. That will be helpful for me, to be honest. Why? I have no clue how much time I really need, because it's the first time. I have a feeling, but feeling and clue are something else. So please keep your questions at the end of this session. And afterwards, we have time enough to drink a beer, cool down, and discuss questions as well. So it shouldn't be an issue. This is the more polite way of view it. User control IT, or controls it. And of course, it is not that black and white, this type of discussion. But this is, when I look at, for instance, Fontys Hogeschool, one of the high schools in the Netherlands, the students who are entering this this building, they have, in most of the cases, this mindset. I will take care of that and I will handle it. Not every student has that mindset, but a lot of students has that mindset. And these students, they will enter the business space within a couple of years. Well, my son is 12. We will find out in a couple of years what his mindset will be, but I'm pretty sure that he will arrange his stuff. That's what I see right now, just watching his phone, his tablet, his laptop at home. I don't explain anything and he is able to take care of that. Well, that mindset is what I mean with user control it. That's also what's called consumerization of IT, as Brian mentioned this morning. Consumerization of IT has nothing to do with technology. It's more like changing the mindset of people. People's mindset are changing and these people are entering the businesses. In some scenarios it will take a while, other scenarios it's pretty fast, like in education, what I mentioned. I have no idea what the pronunciation of Knickerbocker in English is, but it could be Knickerbocker as well. That's what I have no idea. Maybe someone else can correct me if I'm completely wrong with that. But I won't ask who were a Knickerbocker a few years ago. But I did. When I was 12 and 13, my mother said, well, this is the stuff you need to wear. And I was, well, brave or stupid, could be both, to wear it. A few years later, I said, well, if you, I will wear whatever I want to wear. And I want to wear this kind of stuff. So what I want to explain with these two pictures is that people growing are growing and educating and growing in maturity around IT as well, as what I did growing with, well, with my age and, well, listening or not listening to my mother in this sentence. So with consumerization of IT, actually you get the same sort of feeling. Even some adults are still children. That's another discussion. That's off-topic discussion. But overall, when you're adult, you're grown up. And overall, from that perspective, you should be grown up and using IT services as well. And that's what's changing in consumerization of IT. So that was Fewitt, Knickerbocker, and now the third one. The best workplace is, well, it depends. In my scenario, when I'm working from home and traveling to customers, I use four different devices in four different contexts. I use my Windows smartphone or my iPhone. I use my tablets. I use a laptop. I use my laptop connected to 24-inch screens. Within the same role as CTO, within different contexts. Why? Because I want to use different applications and consume different data and information sources. So the best workplace is not one thing. That is obvious. But it's smart to understand this picture. And I think it is pretty tough to write to see it in the back of this room, or even maybe after the third row. But you will find this picture as well in the presentation when you download the presentation. But over here, it says this is the device controlled by IT. And when I move to this side, it's more the end user is on his own, with freedom of hardware, freedom of OS, freedom of applications, no restrictions. And this portion is limited hardware, or limited hardware choice, and restricted policies in various scenarios. Why I'm this presenting on this stage? Because, well, this has everything to do with Windows 8, with consumerization of IT, with bring your own, or choose your own, or buy your own. A lot of customers in our area in the Netherlands have challenges with bring your own from a tablet, smartphone, and laptop perspective, not only a tablet or smartphone perspective. And I think it is smart to understand what these various concepts mean from a self-supporting or self-reliant perspective, from freedom and control. So let me give an example. One of my colleagues is Gerard, and it's tough with being recorded, so that's always scary. But his name is Gerard, and he is an account manager. And within PKR, we have our own choose-your-own program, or actually a buy-your-own program. And Gerard, he actually wants a shiny MacBook machine. And just before I hand over his virtual budget, I ask Gerard, okay, Gerard, suppose you have some strange difficulties with your laptop. Who is helping you with that laptop? Well, my son does. He is studying IT. And when he's not available, my neighbor does. And when he's not available, I will bring my stuff to internal IT. Aha, okay. Good questions. So what I discovered is that Gerard is not self-supporting. Well, just having a discussion with him. From an IT perspective, I shouldn't be the police and judging if he is able to have his own machines. I just want to explain what, from an IT perspective, our expectations are from an end user perspective, and the end user should be able to expect to know what they could expect from IT department. That is the balance between on your own on this side, and this is the device controlled by IT on the other side. So Gerard, in this case, he doesn't need to be self-supporting because IT take care of that. Freedom, well, it's freedom in a golden gauge, or freedom, very limited freedom. And control, well, control is by IT, controlled by the device. And when I move this on this side, self-supporting on this side is maximum. Freedom is maximum as well, but control is minimum from an IT perspective. So control should be shift from a device perspective to a data or application perspective. That is what I want to make clear on this slide. Well, I can imagine that you were wondering, well, what has this to do with Windows 8? Well, this has everything to do with Windows 8, because Windows 8 is not one thing. Windows 8 is a lot of things. Windows 8 is all about use cases. Use cases to use different scenarios in Windows 8. And I will explain these use cases, and I will explain the technology within these use cases. So we will find out what the best workspace is. And the best workspace, of course, is Windows 8. We'll tell the marketing department of Microsoft. But so keep that in mind. And we will find out what Windows 8 in the best workspace will be or will look like. The cool thing of Windows 8 is that there are different form factors of Windows 8. I'm using a Samsung tablet or slate in this scenario, one of the best slates I've experienced so far. And I've played with the Asus, I've played with the Fujitsu as well. And this one is pretty nice, but you cannot compare this Samsung slate running Intel Core i5, 8 gigs of RAM, SSD drive with this Apple iPad. That is apples and oranges, or caravans and Ferraris, or whatever kind of strange combination. Has nothing to do with each other. It's different use cases with, well, different technology as well. So the first thing you will find is when you just pick up this slate after the session is, well, this is heavy. Hey, this battery life is different than this one. That's correct, because it is apples and oranges comparison to each other. So the best workspace in Windows 8 perspective could be a Windows 8 tablet or a laptop or Ultrabook. That's what I am using right now. This laptop is running Windows 8. This tablet is running Windows 8. I have a back order of an Ultrabook with touch with Windows 8. So yes, that is a form factor of Windows 8. Windows RT will be a tablet based on ARM. I don't have access to that tablet. I didn't see anyone outside Microsoft who has access to this tablet. Of course, the hardware manufacturers will have, but time will tell how that will perform. And well, there are some scoops around Nokia and these kind of vendors with tablets based on Windows RT. But for now, it is just what it is, and it's Intel-based Windows 8 systems. Of course, server-hosted desktops, remote desktop services as a whole, but specific remote desktop virtualization host, VDI, virtual desktop infrastructure, and remote desktop services session host, or terminal services. Client hypervisor is part of Windows 8 as well. It's just a feature of a client component, and well, runs pretty cool. And the other way is to go, Windows to go. I will explain what Windows to go is later on. Me like is choice. I like choice. I'm using most of these scenarios in my own work, and I'm not a typical end user. That's for sure, but there are typical a lot of scenarios normal users will use or can use as well. So again, finding out the best workspace is all about use cases. And I explained briefly around different scenarios with Windows 8 and Windows Server 2012. I shouldn't be asking who has seen Tron version 2, because a lot of geeks are here, so most of the people have seen Tron. When I asked, I think 4 weeks ago, it was a different audience, complete different audience, and I want to just determine how geeky the audience was. So I asked that audience how many people have seen Tron, and 3 people showed their hands out of 120. So that was a good signal that I don't need to too technical on that session. At this session, I'm pretty sure that a lot of people have seen Tron. What is Tron all about? It's about users and about programs. Wow, welcome to my world. That is very interesting. It's a lousy story, but great graphics and nice to watch. The Tron is all about application and desktop delivery. And application and desktop delivery is pretty complex. It is bringing applications to the users in different form factors. There are 3 main questions in application and desktop delivery. And these 3 main questions are main questions with Windows 8 and Windows Server 2012 as well. The first question in determining which concept and which strategy around AD fits is where are my applications executed? Are these applications executed locally on my device? Could be a client hypervisor, could be the tablet, could be my rich client, or are these applications executed on the server side? That's the main question with use cases, pros and cons, and so forth and so on. The second question is, okay, how are the applications delivered to the execution platform? Are these Windows applications? Are these web applications? Are these applications rich internet applications, which are meant for native, to run natively on these tablets? And the third question is, how do I manage this combination? How do I manage it from a user perspective with user environment management? And how do I manage it from a device perspective? And even in bring your own scenarios, these three questions can be answered. So these three questions, where is it executed, how are apps delivered to the execution platform, and how do I control that platform, or not control the platform, these are the main three questions in application and desktop delivery. And these three main questions, and especially question one, where is it executed, is a key component in Windows 8 and Windows Server 2012. And by the way, where is my data is part of this key discussion. So where is my data? Is that centralized? How is my network configured? These types of discussions is part of the three questions. So my take on application and desktop delivery from Windows 8 and Windows Server 2012 perspective. Windows 8 tablet, laptop and Ultrabook, enterprise focused, metro style applications. I will show it later what it is and how it works. Legacy, quote unquote legacy Windows applications. 64 bits and 32 bits. And a successor on when you compare it to Windows 7. If it's really a success, time will tell, and especially in the enterprise space. I'm curious, how many people have customers are running Windows 7 by themselves? How many people are running Windows 7 or customers running Windows 7? So most of the people will, I think maybe 80%, something like that. How many of these people will move to Windows 8 within half a year after release? That's what I mean with this one. So there are some reason or skepticism around Windows 8 and the adoption of Windows 8 from a client perspective. Who thinks that Windows RT, besides of iOS and besides of Android, will be the third or a third player within 2 years after release of the tablet of Microsoft? So 30%, something like that. So 30% of the audience think, well, Microsoft will be able, not late, not too late, will be able to handle, to be part of this tablet space. Will be challenging, especially the application store and apps, that will be challenging, and a mindset. Changing the mindset will be challenging, but for now, the information I've seen and the products I've played with, it feels okay, and we'll see in the next months and next years how the adoption will be. Of course, remote desktop services, virtualization host, stateless, pooled, stateless virtual desktops and stateful or assigned virtual desktops are scenarios you can build with this scenario. With these solutions. A remote desktop service session host, obvious, is remote apps and stateless environments. I'm on another machine, I'm running Hyper-V client on Windows 8, and it's pretty cool for an IT pro or a dev perspective. It's not meant, from my perspective, for end users yet. There's no management involved, no management capabilities in the client hypervisor unless you manage your VM with SCCM or these kind of stuff. So the engine is good. Client hosted virtualization, look at Mocha 5, look at Virtual Computer or Citrix, look at Citrix with Zen Client. They are focusing on the client portion and management portion. So it's not only about client, the engine, it's also about management. Who is aware of Windows to Go? Who knows what Windows to Go is? 10%? 2? Maybe less? Well, Windows to Go, I was not able to demonstrate it. I am not sure why, but when I'm booting up my machine with this USB stick, I'm too fast. What is Windows to Go? Windows to Go is this, pretty normal USB drive. Windows 8 is installed on this USB drive with all my applications, with my data, and with my personalization. I can sync it with Microsoft SkyDrive. I can use live IDs to sync my preferences, for instance. But I can boot fast. I can boot fast a Windows 8 machine with this USB drive. I can demonstrate it afterwards. I wasn't able to demonstrate it right now because, for some reason, the external connector didn't work. So showing it to the audience, and especially in the back of this room, is pretty challenging. But I can boot up this device, and the first time I boot, it will take around a minute, depending on what USB port I have, a minute with USB 2. And after the first boot, a small profile of the hardware is being stored on this USB drive. So there's no virtualization involved in Windows to Go. And the second time I boot with that machine, it boots within 20 seconds, something like that. A little bit slower than my local SSD drive, but still very, very powerful and pretty fast. So Windows to Go or Windows 8 could be this simple USB drive. I can give this drive to Michel, boot it on this machine. Enjoy. He's working for Quest, so all his NDA stuff is being copied automatically to my stick, so he is scared of that, that's for sure. But later on, afterwards this session, I'm happy to show Windows to Go. And the performance of the applications running inside the Windows 8 machine, Windows 8 laptop in my case, are just using my local resources. And that is an interesting use case for Windows to Go. When you're interested in building your own Windows to Go stick, it is a normal USB drive, not an El Cheapo USB drive from marketing, which doesn't perform, but a normal USB stick. And I have an explanation how to build your Windows to Go drive with a consumer preview version of Windows 8. So when you're interested, send me an email to rsp@pqr.nl. My email address will be displayed later on as well. Okay, Windows 8, what's new? Well, there's a lot of things to talk about what's new. A couple of months ago, I was in Redmond with a lot of other MVPs. Some people know that that session was a complete full day packed around, especially the server portion of Windows 8, or Windows Server 8, later on Windows Server 2012. So one full day packed of new topics presented by product managers. Well, I'm not able to present all that stuff in 30 minutes or whatever. That's impossible. But what I want to do is just pick some topics and explain what's new and how it works and demonstrate it. So demos, let's see if it works as expected. I did my best to prepare it well. Spent quite some time last weekend. Wife wasn't that happy with that, but yeah, that's part of the game. So let's see if it works. I brought quite some gear with me. I will explain it later what the infrastructure is. So Windows 8, what's new? A lot of new functionality from a desktop perspective in Windows 8 is RemoteFX. So RemoteFX, adaptive graphics, is a technology which will be very helpful in just bringing content in a smart manner to the endpoint. Currently, it's the endpoint Windows 8. We'll see how that will evolve in the next month, if that will be broader or not, we'll see. RemoteFX for WAN. Well, that's important to have WAN connectivity and RemoteFX functionality in that scenario. And RemoteFX for WAN uses TCP and UDP as transport protocol. And when UDP is not possible, it will do a fallback to TCP. Also, the remote desktop gateway will be able to handle both protocols. UDP is very interesting in, transmitting data in a fast way. Maybe not as reliable, but I'm pretty sure that there are other technologies being developed to make it reliable as possible. Multimedia remoting. You will see a rich environment with Silverlight, with Flash, with a lot of multimedia content in the demos as well. And media remoting is being used from a server-hosted perspective, so everything is or almost everything is encoded on the server side and displayed on the client side. Windows 8 is all about touch. When I'm using this device, you can play with this device afterwards when you're interested. But when I'm using this device, it is touch-centric. Of course it is touch-centric, it needs to be. I'm using picture password right now, so I'm logging in with some arrows. And remoting protocol and accessing a Windows 8 VM or a Windows Server 2012 machine with touch functionality on my display is happy to have multi-touch support in the remoting protocol as well. So multi-touch is part of RemoteFX, obvious. And it works pretty flawless. USB remoting for both VDI and terminal services, so for both virtual host, remote desktop service virtualization host, and remote desktop service session host, and that is new. The USB stack and the implementation is different compared to the Windows Server 2008 R2 compared to Server 2012. So full USB support in Windows Server 2012 should be part of the stack. And that is, well, that's cool to have. I'm not sure why, but I wasn't able to configure it or test it and demo this functionality. This is what I've heard, that this functionality is part of the game. But it could be that my consumer preview of Windows Server 2012 is not able to handle it today. I'm not sure why, but that's what I discovered today. Maybe someone else has different experience, but I couldn't make it happen, full USB support in a session host environment today. But remote desktop client, Metro style desktop application, I will show it. And RemoteFX, you can use a physical GPU, graphical processor unit, or use the CPU as well for compression, encoding graphics inside of VM or outside of VM. Adaptive graphics, how does it work? It will detect different content and will use different encoders or different policies around these encoders to display this type of content for the end user. Progressive rendering, Citrix and VMware have this technology a long time in their solution. But you'll see that the text, you won't see it in the back of this room, but trust me, the text is clear and the picture is getting clearer after a couple of milliseconds or seconds, depending on the scenario. And therefore, from a user perspective, it feels like, okay, I can do my stuff, and the picture is being rendered and being created within a couple of milliseconds later on. Remote desktop management services is new. So management of remote desktop services, managing from one perspective, both VDI and terminal services. Fair share, so network load balancing on CPU, on memory, and on CPU, disk, and network level. Memory is not correct, sorry about that. So CPU, disk, and network level, I can set triggers to load balance my desktop session. Active. Connection broker config, pretty simple to configure. You need a SQL database and you can load balance your connection brokers. Use a profile disk, a VHD file, and this VHD file is the storage where my user profile is being stored. So I can configure a user profile disk and everything is being redirected to this VHD file. That's helpful when you're in a VDI or terminal server environment, especially in VDI scenario, when you have a mixed environment and all customers have. You will need other solutions besides of this user profile disk, so other user environment management solutions. Patching VMs, personal and pooled VMs is new, and especially the combination of Server 2012, server message blocks, file service, and Hyper-V, that is an interesting combination as a whole. Some random thoughts before I will move to the demo stuff. Benny Twitch, he mentioned, good timing, Benny. I think the endpoint is exciting. Maybe it's not an exciting thing, but from a remote desktop protocol perspective, Benny and Sean showed that the endpoint is exciting. The end user experience can vary when you have different endpoints. Look at iOS, look at Android, look at Windows, look at macOS. The end user experience can vary when you have RemoteFX or other remote desktop protocols. Well, today there is no client for these types of scenarios. I have no clue if there will be a Windows 8 or a Remote FX client for iOS or OS X or Android or whatever kind of platform. We'll see, but customers are asking for these type of functionality. That is for sure. If that will be available, I have no clue. We'll see, time will tell. But the combination of client and endpoint, is the protocol war over? No, it's not over. Benny and Sean demonstrated in their session a couple of hours ago that there's a big difference in the different types of content being displayed on different different types of endpoints. So protocol war is over? No, as Benny mentioned, and that's a good quote, it's just started. And I'm fine with that. I'm pretty sure that he is right with that. So demo time, finally. I prepared some stuff. I will get some paperwork with that. Gabe bought a nice VGA switch this weekend. This awesome device. Why? Because I've asked, okay, I have a couple of devices, how can I switch? I will bring a switch. Well, that's cool. But this switch only switches when I'm using a keyboard or mouse connected. Well, that's really old school stuff, right? My iPad doesn't have this type of connector, so I couldn't switch it. And even my laptop doesn't have both of these devices or one of these devices. So, thanks, Gabe. But that doesn't work. So I will use the cable. I'll use the workaround scenario. Who already played with a Windows 8 tablet? Handful of people. Benny has one. You have an Asus, right? Yeah. Yeah. Let's see if it works. Yep. Yeah. Oh. Interesting to see what you can do with this. I don't have internet connectivity with this tablet. But touch, of course, touch is part of the game. Playing games like this one. Let's see if that works without internet. No idea. You see the charm bar on this side or on this side. I can play other games as well. You can switch applications when switching my finger over this side. Or use the charms bar and move to the start menu. So this is what Microsoft calls the new start menu. There's quite some debate if this is the best start menu ever. That's not a discussion. For now, it works pretty well. Benny, how are your experiences?
Yeah, it does work on the tablet.
Yeah.
It doesn't really work on the standard.
What I've experienced is when you're used to this tablet, and you worked a complete evening with this tablet, and then I'm moving to my normal laptop, I'm pinching my screen on my normal laptop. And it has nothing to do with beer or mojito. It's just just natural, I think. So. Other thing is finding the shutdown button over here is helpful as well. There it is. Cut the rope. Famous game. Not really smart with that, but it's pretty cool to use a touch for that. That was an easy one, right? This is the, well, old school desktop interface from a Metro perspective. What is wrong with this? Well, nothing wrong with that, but no start button. That's, in some degree, if it works just using this and using search, for instance, for starting applications. But it took me a few days before I was really adjusted to having no start menu, to be honest. That's, well, maybe this is just me. I have no idea. Benny, how about you?
Yeah, I added a start button to my
okay.
Cool. There's a trick how to do that.
Yeah.
It doesn't look like the old one, but it's good enough for me.
Okay. Okay, so we'll see how that will evolve in the next month. But the interesting, why is it called Metro? Have anyone any clue why it's Metro? And that, well, by the way, it has nothing to do with Metro or trains not running. That's has nothing to do with Metro. It is called Metro because of the map, Metro map. And well, I'm using Windows Phone for 2 years right now, and I'm used to the ability to switch between contexts, to have a combination of contexts and making pictures and upload it to Facebook, for instance. So having access to, having fast access to content, that is part of this, well, the Metro philosophy within Microsoft. Well, SkyDrive integration, Facebook integration, that is all part of this platform. Pretty cool. Without internet, it's tough to have this demonstrated, but it works pretty well. You'll see remote desktop client over here. This is a Metro-style remote desktop client. These applications are the applications I've published in my scenarios over here. I will use these applications later. And this type of functionality is working as well in a remote desktop session host or remote desktop virtualization host environment. Yes, it consumes bandwidth, but not that extreme as within Windows 7. Of course, Windows 7 didn't have any touch support. When you look at the bandwidth consumption in Windows 7, it was outrageous. Sometimes even my Wi-Fi wasn't able to handle that. Well, that's not WAN optimized. Today, a lot of people in Redmond saw demos of remote effects over WAN with a few hundred kilobytes per second bandwidth with 100 milliseconds latency. And these applications with various content worked good over with Windows 8 and Windows 2012. Try to demonstrate it later on. Okay, so this is my Windows 7 device. The funny thing of this device is there's a smart docking station as well. So I'm using this device. This is the dock. I dock it in this machine. I have a wireless keyboard, and I'm using a mouse as well. And I can undock it and use it whatever I want. So that is a smart combination of, well, sort of laptop and tablet combined within Samsung. I'm happy with that. It runs pretty well. To be honest, I had some issues. There's HDMI connection on the back, but finding a good connector for HDMI to VGA was pretty challenging, to be honest. I bought three different cables, and both three didn't work. So now I bought an expensive converter, €100, and that should work. We'll see. But that's the reason why I'm not using this dock in the demo. I already explained the remote desktop Metro-style application. In this scenario, I will use the RD Web client as well. Various types of applications are being published, published by session host machines, especially these remote applications, and three different VDI or remote desktop virtualization host scenarios. Created some folders as well. Pretty straightforward, to be honest. So there are three ways, or maybe multiple. In this case, there are three ways of accessing my applications. I can use a Metro-style application, remote desktop Metro-style application. I can use RD Web, and I can use my updated. See, this is why I'm using just Windows R. You can use the classic remote desktop connector client as well. What is new with this client? Benny called it late connection hints, and that is what's new in this client, for instance. So when I'm looking at experience, you see detect connection quality automatically. That is a connection hint, and it has huge impact in what the end user experience will be when I'm switching from wireless to 3G to LAN, for instance. So it will automatically detect what the bandwidth is and what kind of latency I have. And that's new in the client, and the server components, they are able to handle this kind of functionality as well. What I did as well is configure some group policies. Why? or to handle this USB support. So I want to have full USB support, and I configured a few group policies to handle this these USB devices. I have some strange USB devices in, connected to my laptop, and well, that's the device I will use in a demo later on. Group policy, pretty straightforward, to be honest. I had quite some difficulties in finding the right performance with RemoteFX, to be honest. That's the reason why I was busy last weekend, and my wife didn't like that. And she was right, but couldn't change it. I had some difficulties. Why? In this setup, and in the setup at home, I'm using NVIDIA GPUs. And for some reason, the NVIDIA drivers are not that great yet for Windows 8. I've seen some strange things, crashes, RemoteFX working functionality from a functional perspective, but not performing as what I expected. So it took, well, I think 2.5 days before I really said it. One of my machines is not able to run RemoteFX, although it's a pretty powerful machine with an NVIDIA card. This newer laptop has an NVIDIA Quadro 1000 inserted, and RemoteFX is running fine on that machine. Of course, it's still a laptop. And my machine at home has an NVIDIA Quadro 4000, and that works fine as well. So when you want to test with RemoteFX in your own environment, you can use, well, normal graphical cards. It works, or it could work. That's a better description. When you're in production environments, use graphical cards which are part of the hardware compatibility list. That's obvious when it's being released. So what did I bring with me a couple of days ago? This. Customs was happy with that. There was just one belt, one line through security check in Schiphol. You know it, you have seen it, eh? And a lot of people were standing behind me, and blue suitcase, beep. All my laptops were already removed. And this lady said, well, who is this bag? What's inside this bag? Because for me, it's just one black thing. That's because there are all just cables inside that container. So it took, I think, 5-6 minutes before everything was outside that container, and everything was on the right order on that on a belt. But it was fun. I was not able to make pictures of that. I was not allowed to do it, but it was fun to see. This is the setup. Two Hyper-V hosts, Hyper-V1, Hyper-V3, Hyper-V2 is at home. 32 gigs of RAM, SSD drives, Core i7 on both sides. This is a brand new laptop. This is a laptop, I think, a year and a half. Something like that. NVIDIA, different NVIDIA cards, but both powerful enough to demonstrate whatever I want. Hyper-V replication, live storage migration, live vMotion. That's what I want to demonstrate later on. RemoteFX, so I'm running a couple of VMs, Windows 8 VMs on this machine. RemoteFX enabled. Using my own wireless network adapter. You never know what you can expect on these events. Gigabit network connection. And this is just a typical Windows 8 laptop, HP laptop. iPad with me for another demo and a Windows 7 tablet. And that fits in hand luggage. So I'm wearing 4 days the same underwear. No. There was a smell. No, that's not me. So yeah, it fits and it works, and we'll see if it works in a demo as well. So what can we do? Let's see if we can find some stuff in the Windows 8 VM. I will make a manual connection right now. Later on, I will use the connection broker. Talking and typing is always challenging. Maybe that's a man thing. Doing two or three things together doesn't work. Or maybe it's just me. This is one of the things. This bar over here is the determining what kind of bandwidth and what kind of latency I have. UDP is being used, and you see some numbers as well. What can we show? DirectX application. Pretty cool. Even in WAN scenarios and in wireless scenarios, I've seen it in my home office. It runs pretty well. Let's see what kind of bandwidth we are using. It takes the bandwidth which is available. And that's a good thing when it's available. Let's see what is being used. Not bad, right? Look at the amount of frames per second. Just when I'm just running this application on my normal laptop, I get the same sort of numbers. Be aware that RemoteFX in Windows 7 and Windows 8 is meant for line of business applications, not for Call of Duty, not for Guitar Hero, not for Autodesk Revit or these types of applications. Could work. Well, Call of Duty doesn't work. I tried that, but that doesn't work as expected, but it's not meant for that. Angry Birds could work, didn't try that. So what I tried, what I did, I just downloaded the complete website of this, animated storytelling thing around Tron. Why? Well, there's no internet connection, so I need to download this application, and I want to demonstrate this type of application with RemoteFX. And this is what a normal user will expect from a performance perspective in these scenarios. I can use touch as well, but my laptop doesn't have touch. I could use the other one as well. This is how it should work in LAN and WAN scenarios. I downloaded the Avengers. Who've seen the movie Avengers? A couple of people. I've seen a movie with my son. It's a style of movie you like or you don't like it, but it's a funny movie. I like the movie anyway. But so I copied the trailer to this machine. It's 1080 resolution, so pretty cool. Pretty nice, right? In this bar over here, you can use a charms bar as well. So the charms bar is what I did with my finger, but then in a remote desktop session. And that's useful to enter, for instance, the start menu, like I did here. Interesting. Artifact, yeah, I think so. Irritating. Reboot, yeah, so could be.
Control or delete still work.
Yeah, that's my local machine. That will work. Let's kill this beast. I tried to use my mouse as a touch interface as well, but that doesn't work. you get used to this touch interface and using your mice and your own fingers with this non-touch enabled device. But that's you will experience yourself later on when you're playing with this. So that's pretty cool, right? Using this type of stuff. Of course, USB redirection works. I'm able to connect this, well, PQR, easy USB drive. But it's fun to connect other USB drives as a USB device as well. So Nelly Porter demonstrated in, I think, Bryform 2 years ago. Yeah, something like that. Playing Guitar Hero with, I think, Calista these days. I'm not really a Guitar Hero fan, so what I did, I just brought my famous USB missile launcher with me. And the funny thing of this USB missile launcher is that there are two portions of that. It's a software component. This software component runs inside my VM, and it's USB redirection. So I can control this device. Let's see. And you see, I've played with this device before because I'm missing one of my rockets. I shoot it in the audience, and I forget to pick up this rocket. And one of the ladies who were cleaning the room, obvious, thought, this is an interesting thing. Let's bring it at home. So I'm missing one of the rockets right now, but so it works. That's obvious. Yeah, that's my trick, just to pick up right the launcher and the rockets. And then, so this is, well, USB remoting. This should work in session host as well, but I'm not able to get it up and running right now. As mentioned before, I have no idea why, but we will find out when the solution is final and see if it's me or maybe just something you cannot configure right now. We'll see.
For no device or just not for that device?
For non-device, non-full USB support, as mentioned in
how did you get missiles through customs?
I'm looking for, just off topic, I'm looking for other strange USB devices, which is a combination of device and software. So no coffee warmers or these kind of things, because that's not really interesting. When you have great smart ideas, just let me know. Other applications like this one will work. Pretty cool. Sylvite application. So this is a Sylvite app, and everything is rendered remotely and displayed locally. So pretty simple applications, but cool to see how it performs in this scenario. Play with this one. Let's see something else. It will take a while before this Lonely Planet website is loaded. I think it will check if some components are available in the public network. And well, I don't have any public network access, so it will take a while. But when it's done with checking, the application and the website will run, and we'll use that application as well. And of course, other content documents will, well, perform as you expect they perform. So finally, with remote effects, you see, I spent quite some time with remote effects because it's a key component in VDI. And with Windows 7 and 2008 R2, it was okay in LAN scenarios, but there were too much caveats in that. Move on, Windows 8, 2012, a huge improvement on the user experience in LAN and WAN scenarios, with touch, with USB, all these kind of scenarios. And that's a good thing. Let's see if I demonstrated whatever I want. Nope, not yet. Just want to show the Hyper-V1. This machine works. This machine works as well. These are my Windows 8 machines. And interesting to see is when I'm looking for remote effects. Let's see if zoom it works. Should work. Not inside my VM anymore. Okay, that's a pity. So managing GPUs, I've just one, using one NVIDIA Quadro 1000 in my machine. I can enable it. I can see how many VMs are using this GPU, how much memory is available. Memory consumption is depending on resolution, is depending on how much monitors I have configured as well. And inside the VM, when I'm just using, just configure this straightforward. You need second level address translation, MPT or EPT, within your hardware to use remote effects, besides of the right GPU and drivers. That combination is important. And I already explained I had some difficulties with the NVIDIA, but the current Windows 8 beta drivers of NVIDIA, they work and they don't crash with this HP EliteBook machine. So when you have questions around hardware for testing purposes, just let me know. Maybe I can help you with that. So switch topic. Talked about application and desktop delivery, remote desktop services, virtualization host, session host. Had some fun with rocket launchers and played some movies. Everything works as expected. One thing, what's on my to-do list is to have a WAN simulator in a portable format as a VM or something like that, to have the same demos I have seen in Redmond using remote effects in WAN scenarios. But I couldn't find the time to build that scenario, but that's on my to-do list for next week. And well, that would be nice to demonstrate later on other events like this. Okay, let's move to Windows Server 2012 with Hyper-V, and first check what's new with Hyper-V. Live storage migration with local storage. That's interesting. In both scenarios, I don't have any shared storage with me. I have some shared storage at home and in my demo lab, but these are just two normal VMs. What I can do, I can migrate, do a live migration with VM and storage without shared storage with Hyper-V in Server 2012. I can create a replication schedule between VMs. I will do that in a demo. I will say, okay, replicate this VM on Hyper-V 3 and replicate it to Hyper-V 1. Through the network, without any shared storage, I'm able to replicate these VMs inside my own private network. And we'll see how it works in the upcoming month, but we'll see if Microsoft will be able to replicate these types of VM to their Azure platform as well, because that will be an interesting scenario. So replicating VMs from your private network to the Microsoft Azure platform with Hyper-V and later on Azure, that's an interesting scenario. Networking. There were quite some difficulties with networking in Windows Server 2008 R2. Network teaming, extensibility, all these kind of things. Even my network colleagues, they think, well, finally, they got it. Something like that. And networking there are a lot of changes in networking. Offloaded data transfer. So using snapshot technology from storage vendors is part of the Hyper-V platform as well. And that is smart in cloning VMs and these kind of things. Data deduplication, storage pools, all these types of stuff is part of, well, Hyper-V, not really Hyper-V, but more the infrastructure as a whole within Windows 2012. And again, I can talk for a couple of hours around new features with dynamic access control, with DHCP, with file services, and so forth and so on. That's not the goal in this session. So some demos around Hyper-V and replication. That is my goal. Let's see if it works. So I have two connections, Hyper-V 1 and Hyper-V 3. Let's see what I will pick. These are machines, they are both off. Let's see if I can put it on. This is just a server core machine. So Windows Server 2012 server core. Shouldn't it be that hard to start it. There it is. That's stupid. Sorry about that. Made it full screen, but that was not the purpose. I'm struggling, but that's obvious. This was what I'm looking for. Nope. Come on. I'll use another one. Let's see if that works. So enable replication is already replicated. So I will remove replication. It's a learning experience for me as well. Sorry about that. But that's part of the game. Enable replication. And I will replicate this VM to my other machine, IPv1. Let's see how fast that is. It's just a Windows Server 8. And it's, well, copying the VM to the other Hyper-V machine through LAN without any shared storage. And I'm, well, within a couple of minutes, I have a copy of that machine. Should have a copy of that machine on the... Let's see if I can pick another one, just to make sure. Scabros, compression, this VHD. Recovery points is okay. A good demo is always challenging. We'll see if this will work. Otherwise, find it out yourself or trust me. Firewall could be. That's a good one. I've encountered that as well. So firewall is default disabled with replication. But I already already had that configured later. So they're all on. Just to be sure, but shouldn't be an issue. I'm in a domain, so replication should work, flawless, awesome, great. And well, moving this type of machines, we'll see if that will work right now. But moving this type of machine. Move to a single data store, single location. Where do I want to move it? I want to use it in this folder, next, and finish. And then my machine is moved. My VM is being moved to the other machine. I forgot to power on this machine, but you will see that even in a running scenario, I can move the VMs. You see that there are some issues. We'll see. Our machine already exists. That makes sense. Let's see if I can use another one as well. Let's move this running machine. See if the demo gods are with me. Move virtual machine. The machine is up and running. This is my demo machine I used before in the rocket launcher demo. This is machine 3, so I should pick this one. Single location, that's okay. Folder. see if it will work. Ah, there's some issues. What the issue is in this specific scenario, what I should configure is on the CPU side, there's compatibility mode. And I didn't enable that. And the Core i7 on this laptop has different functionality than the Core i7 on this laptop. Should I should enable the compatibility mode before I move this specific machine? But I've played with this move and replication a couple of times, and didn't work in the first time because of the firewall issue. That's correct. And afterwards, it runs, and within a couple of minutes, I'm able to move a running VM, of course, depending on the site, and I'm able to replicate VMs from one VM Hyper-V host to another Hyper-V host. It's a pity that it doesn't work in this demo, but yeah, it's part of the show. Okay, a couple of minutes. Some various things, and then the final and last demo, and that's running Windows 8 on an ARM-based device. That's pretty cool. So using IE10, by the way, did you know that there are there's one version of IE10 but with different functionality? That this Internet Explorer version and these Internet Explorer they have different functionality. The Metro-style Internet Explorer, from a security perspective, doesn't have the ability to use plugins, for instance. So when I'm using the Metro-style Internet Explorer, I'm not able to use YouTube and use Flash content to display in the browser. I have no idea if that's by design and not changeable, but that's what I encountered playing with the solution. So be aware of that. Windows Store, so Application Store is new. I already explained that in the touch demo. Task Manager, you already saw that in the demo using a performance monitor, for instance. Like this one, new Task Manager. Find it pretty useful, to be honest. It works pretty well. Explorer with ribbons, even usable in a Windows-based tablet. I can use the Explorer pretty flawless. File copying, multiple files, I can copy and I can resume these types of copy actions. Starting at my tablet, within a couple of seconds, my tablet from scratch is started. 10 seconds in that area, and resuming my tablet is what you expect with tablets. Picture password, I cannot demonstrate it right now, but when you're interested how picture password works, is you have certain combinations in a picture, and these combinations make sure that I can log into my tablet. Syncing settings in the cloud, what does it mean? Settings, my Metro style applications, my personalization are being synced with my live ID to the Microsoft cloud. And I'm using the same idea of the same connection with this laptop and this tablet with the same ID, and the settings I've configured on this device are being used on this device, the other devices as well. So that's an interesting feature for more consumer focused or enterprises with lower demands, from my perspective. Last thing, one more thing. I tweeted about it. What I want to demonstrate is, and see if it works. It worked in the preparation. Let's see if it works right now. Just preparing some stuff. Some people are wondering, okay, how much does a tablet cost? This tablet costs around 1,000 euros, and that's pretty expensive. Maybe tough to talk about these types of expenses at home, could be. I'm running an Apple iPad, so an ARM-based device with Windows 8 and with all of the... This is the application I played couple of minutes ago. Sorry about that. Can I change that? So this is not the type of demonstration I will do at TechEd or these types of events, but for demo purposes. So you can use your iPad as a touch-based device with wireless connectivity to this access point. With all the stuff this is tricky, sorry. Didn't prepare it. Not sure if you can see it, but it will be tough. But I'm just screen copying this iPad to this device using FlashTop. And it works pretty well. Even audio and video works. I'm not sure if this is a good idea, but didn't prepare that. Almost the cable. So FlashTop is the application you can use for this type of demo purposes. So it's specific for Windows 8, well, they have a specific client. I have a couple of machines configured with FlashTop. I'm just connecting to this machine right now. Within a couple of seconds, I'm able to use, well, this machine. Pretty cool, right? So running Windows 8 on an ARM-based tablet, that's pretty cool. Without having access to Windows RT. I prepared an email a couple of days ago, just a few minutes before I will finish. I prepared an email a couple of days ago, and that email is called Windows 8 Red Bull or Win 8 Red Bull. Why? Because there's a lot of content in this presentation about Windows to Go, about RemoteFX, which is smart to share. And I already spent quite some time in collecting all this kind of information, and I'm happy to share that with you as well. So when you're happy to receive that kind of information, send me an email, something like Windows 8 Red Bull. Email address will be displayed in the slide after this one. So to summarize this session, it's about use cases, use cases, use cases. I showed the Windows to Go. I played with touch. I played with the desktop virtualization. Didn't play with client Hyper-V. That's pretty straightforward. The protocol war is over. No, it is just started, and especially with the new functionality within RemoteFX. We'll see how it works with other devices without Windows running Windows 8. Windows 8 will be focused on consumer and business. So we'll see how the tablet, how that will evolve and what the adoption rate will be from a consumer and business perspective. And don't wait with Windows 8. Just play with it, evaluate it, test it, share knowledge. Let me know when you have questions or other funny things you want to share. And I want to say enjoy the ride. I hope you had, fun with this as well. In the other session, the VDI Smackdown, I mentioned that, for me, Mojito is celebrating success. Not all demos worked, so it will be a small Mojito this afternoon, I think. But celebrating success, the other session was cool. This one was cool as well. Two demos didn't work, part of the game. I hope you liked this session and the content and get some inspiration around Windows 8 and Windows Server 2012. I hope you liked it. And I want to thank you and have a great evening.